Thank you, Andreas, for the introduction. And it's a pleasure to be here and speak about a topic I really like. One minor mistake, we cannot reduce the complexity of distributed systems. We can only manage the complexity. So it will not go away. It will always stay here. Before I start with the talk, I want to give a disclaimer. The intention of my talks is usually to inspire you, give you a broader tool set for C++ usage. Might not be helpful to go tomorrow and implement everything I tell you. All the slides are slideware. They actually work. I have a repository where you can look up everything. I have a link at the end of the slide. And yeah, I hope you learn something and can take away some ideas or get some inspiration. And yeah. For the complexity of distributed systems, you might have noticed that there is a gap between architecture and implementation. Why is that? And how can we handle this better? But before we start, I want to give you a short introduction to a distributed system. And a distributed system is basically a system with many integral parts. So like many different machines or many different processes. It depends actually on the use case, but usually a network is involved and things get complicated when you have to integrate a big system. So for one, it's kind of complex and it's very hard to test actually, because you might have hardware involved and a cluster or whatever. Before I want to explain, I have a very simplified complex system. So everybody is on the same page and we know what we are talking about. So I painted some nice graphics. So we have a user human interface here with a mouse and a keyboard and a screen. And then we have the nice user and he will use his mouse cursor usually to trigger some action. That's like we interact with a normal PC all the time. Nothing different here. But on a distributed system, then the complexity starts. So usually we create a command from the action. This command is transferred over network to some other system. And this is usually termed as a server because it's executing the command. And before we can execute the command, we have to validate that this command is valid. So we filter out all the invalid commands that some other user might have stepped on its toes. And then we also have to ensure that the sequence of commands is transferred into an event, and these events have to be stored. So we have to somehow store data somewhere. And once we have stored these events, we can distribute them. And if you have a complex system, you might have multiple computers listening to those events, and they will want to do some computations on the new event data. And from these computations, you derive some updates. And those updates usually go back to the screen of the user. Might be a different user, but again, it's a screen. And you have different perspectives, you have different representations of the same data. For the viewers, you might use whatever system you have. For example, Qt, that's my favorite. So we will see later how this goes. So now you have all the terms I use for these distributed systems, like actions, commands, servers, events, computations, updates, and so on. So then the question becomes, how can we design such a system? So how can we keep everything in sync? So we have to keep in sync that the server understands the command, that the computations understands the events, and everything has to somehow fit together. So nothing. Everything has to be in sync. So how can we design such a system? I mean, we have visualized now the data flow like for a very simple system. Usually there are much more complex, more specialized systems involved and so on. So we can, for one step, show such a data flow and make sure everyone is on the same page. But we also have to ensure the data compatibility. And we have to communicate everything to the developers. So that's the goal for today. I want to show you how can we manage with that. So yeah, next step, we go to C++ again. So from the very high level back to basic level. I want to introduce you to strong types. Usually I ask if everybody has heard about strong types, but you cannot answer right now. So I will give you the presentation how strong types are defined. So first, what problem are we using strong types for? So imagine we have a very simple structure, like a point, which has linear values in each dimension, x, y, z. So it's a point in a three-dimensional space. And everything is clear because the order of x, y, z is somehow normative. Yeah, you wouldn't be too happy if someone orders them differently. But what they mean is actually a bit different. But one day, some new developer comes along and tries, yeah, we have more. Like, for example, we add a weight. Or we have texture coordinates. And now we have six doubles in one struct. And when we initialize this struct, what order are they in? Is the weight before the texture coordinates? Is the texture coordinates before the weight? Yeah, it becomes problematic because everything is a double. The compiler won't help you because it's just double. So you can mix and match like whatever you want. So now this is an issue we want to solve. And you get the same issue if you have a function with like six arguments. It's the same issue. You have like six doubles, but everything goes in every parameter, but compiler won't help you if you mix it up. So how would you solve this? One very easy solution is we make a structure for each field. For x, y, z, we create three different structures. And our point then becomes an implementation of these structures. Now, the big benefit now is that every coordinate has its own type. So you cannot mix it. You cannot assign a y coordinate to an x because it's a different type. In the first place, when you create the x coordinate, you have to use the constructor of the x struct. There's no automatic conversion. That's the whole point. And then it's clear that you are using a double as an x coordinate. So it's very useful. And now it's the structure for the point is somehow redundant. We have the x type and the x field. So they're the same. So we don't need that. So we can simplify everything and use a standard tuple. So we just use the types as fields in our structure. Yeah. That's the way to go. So now we're asking ourselves, do we have to write this boilerplate for the structure all the time, or can we do better? And when I gave this talk last year, I said, yeah, we can use templates for that, but they're not good enough. So I will present you my new technique I'm using right now. So what I'm doing is I define a weak struct. It's weak because it only gets one template argument, and that's the value. So we store the value in the structure, and we define some constructors. So we have a default constructor, so we can create empty weak types, and we have an explicit conversion constructor. So we have to name the type. And yeah, we move in the value just for efficiency reasons. And now we use C++ 20 to also generate an equals operator. So this allows us to compare two weak types of the same value type. So this is still weak. That's not strong because if we would create a weak from a double, it's still a weak double. And the arcsol coordinate is still a weak double. So to make it strong, I use a macro. It's not pretty, but it works. And you will see why I'm using it. So what I do is I create a new structure with a name. So if you have a x, we name it x, and the value would be a double. And we inherit privately from the weak type. So there's no automatic conversion from any weak type to another weak type because it's private inheritance. Then we make available the constructors. So we allow explicit construction from the value type. And we also allow the access to the value inside of our structure. And then this allows us also to use the comparison operator. And the reason why I still have this weak type, I could have written everything in the macro then, is that we cannot decide if the equal operator is const expr or not. And if you use a template like that, then they become const expr automatically. I don't know why this is, but yeah, that's what I found out. And next thing is, I define a function that gives me an indication that this type name is indeed a strong type. So I don't have to use SwinIA and anything to find out if this is a strong type or not. That's just for performance reasons. And this macro also allows me to define names. So I can get the same structure, is strong. Give me the name of this strong value or strong type. Okay. That's as far as I want to go for this presentation in strong types. If we want to learn more, there are a lot of talks online about strong types. I want to link to this talk from Barney Delar. It's last year on C++ on C, strong types in C++. And he goes into all the details you might want to know. And a very famous use case I will also want to mention is the standard Kronos library. They use strong types for all the types, like milliseconds and seconds, and do type conversions. You can go quite far with that. But for the purpose of my talk here, we only need strong types to isolate types and dimensions like in the position. Okay, now let's use our macro. So we have to define x double and y z. And when we create a struct like before. And it's a bit more clean than using structs all the time, because you will have to add these constructors sooner or later, and then you have to change every implementation of a strong type. So it's better to use a macro. And we can, of course, use a tuple here again, because it's just x, y, z. So the types are the field names as well. Okay, now the next step. We want to go a level up. So we are now quite deep in C++, so very basic stuff like structures and coordinates. And to get a bit more into the concepts, we might not say we have a standard tuple, because this tuple involves an implementation. We want to basically say, we have all of the x, y, z. And this leads us into the realm of the data schema. That's the next topic here. So if you have questions for the strong types or anything I said before, then it might be a good place to ask them. Or we move on to the data schema part.
There was one comment in the chat by Alex Cohn, whether the operator equals is necessary or not.
Yeah, the question is, why do you need this operator in weak if you already have it in strong?
Yeah, that's a good question. I guess, without knowing it definitely, if you have the auto equals operator, this only works if the all the inherited types also have the equals operator. So like a double has an equals operator, so it works because it's a field and a weak type. But if we inherit from weak, then weak also has to have an equals operator, and it's not automatically generated if we don't force the compiler to generate it. So that's a trait in C++ 20, I guess, that we get the automatic generation for equals operators, but only if we force the compiler to do that. If you wouldn't write this equals line, then there would be no equals operator, and the strong structure would not be able to default the implementation.
So strong will not compile?
Yes, that's my guess.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Okay, any other question? reply. If not, then let's continue. So we entered a realm of the data schemas. And data schemas are basically the key to all the managing the complexity in the distributed systems here. So you might have seen data schemas. So they are quite everywhere. So I stumbled upon them on XML schemas first. So you can write a schema that defines how your XML structure is laid out. There's also the same thing for JSON, where you define how your JSON document is laid out, or what fields exist, and what are mandatory, and so on. And there's also like a data definition language, which is used for distributed systems to define the data schema, or the shared damage schema in distributed systems. Now, the trick here is that we try to define the data schema in C++ itself. So you won't use any data schema language like XML or JSON or the DDL languages that exist. We just use C++ here. So it's best viewed as an example. So I have my point data structure we defined before. Let's reuse that. And then we can say, okay, a sequence of points, that's points. And from points and faces and shaders, we might get some geometry. And if we combine geometry with something else, so one of geometry, light or camera, is an object. So might be a light or a camera or a geometry. And with a hierarchy of objects, we get a scene. So like a computer gaming scene or whatever. And we can combine the scene with a name. So all of name and scene, we get a document. And we might have in our application multiple documents at the same time, like in Word where you have multiple documents open. And this is actually C++. And to get the point across, let's look at the same schema, but from a graphical perspective, might be more familiar. So we start on the other side with a document, and the document basically, the documents and help contains many documents. Each document is containing an ID and the document itself. The document part consists of the name and the scene in our case. The scene is a hierarchy, so it contains multiple objects in the hierarchy. Each object has an ID, and the object itself splits up into either a geometry, a light, or a camera. So it's one of those. And for geometry, we defined more. The geometry contains of points, faces, shaders, and maybe more. And our points is a list of points, and each point is a XYZ. So, and you can imagine we can model quite of different and very large complex data definitions or schemas. So how does this actually work in a C++ world then? So the trick is that, yeah, that's the question. And the trick is that all of our types we used before are basically empty structures. So the all of is just an empty structure. We don't use it for anything real. We just need it to be a placeholder and contain the type arguments. The same is for the one of. So for C++, there's nothing different between an all of and a one of. But of course, we as a user want to interpret them differently. And the same goes. Sequence of is just one type argument. And entity set might have an ID and a type. And then hierarchy has an ID, also a content type. Yeah, it's very basic types, nothing special about them. Now the magic is we can use these schemas and generate code from that. So let's make use of that. And that's what I call type-driven code generation or type-driven development. And to get a basic perspective, what we want to do is, for example, we want to store an all of. So as we have seen, all of our point was stored as a tuple. So we have an all of with some template arguments, and we want to derive a tuple from that. So that's not valid C++, even though it is a semicolon already in there. Let's make it C++. So first thing first, we need to have a template argument list. So we have a template pack, TS, of all the types the all of gets. And next step, this is not expressing that we want to store the all of. So we want to make it like storage for all of. And now this already looks like a function signature, just missing some auto, and the tuple also has no types. So the question is, what goes into the tuple then? And the trick here is that we have to do recursive, because each of our types might be a recursive schema type again. So we go storage for TS for all of our TSs. So this creates a tuple that contains the storage for all the TS that we have given the all of. So now this is still not valid C++, because that's not a function right now. So, and we also don't want to have a function. We want to have a type back. We don't want to have a tuple because we wouldn't know what to put into the tuple. So what we do is we use a storage for type alias that just uses the return type of our storage for. So we use a storage for function now. That's a lowercase storage for. This gives a null pointer to a type T. And we want to capture the return type. So now the function implementation would be a real actual function, storage for. And we get a pointer to the all of. And you might think this works, but C++ always is a bit more complicated than it has to have. This doesn't work because we have recursion right now. So the storage for type alias is defined before our storage for function signature. So it wouldn't even find the storage for function because C++ states that templates only find functions that are coming before the template definition. So to fix that, C++ always has another trick that makes everything work again. We have to use ADL, so argument dependent lookup. So we add another argument to our function. That's basically a null pointer to the ADL pointer. And also add this pointer to our function. And ADL is now an empty structure. It's not even implemented. That lives in the same namespace as our storage for type alias and storage for function. And this is a trick. This works very well. So now we are able to recursively generate everything from our schema. So we use function signatures that map from our concepts, so our schema types, to actual implementation types. So for the storage of our all of, we use a tuple here. But we might use a different type, and it's very easy to change because all our all of implementations use the same code generation for the storage. And with that, we can go further and do the same thing for all our other types. So for example, the one-off would be implemented in a standard variant because a standard variant actually models the one-off model very well. And for a sequence, we might use a vector because vector is the basic sequence type. But for your actual application, maybe vector is not ideal because you have different or more constraints on your sequence. But for this demonstration, it works very well. And not everything is quite that simple. So for example, the entity set that wants to store all the entities. And each entity has an ID and the storage for T. So it's recursive again, but it uses vector and tuple combined. That's all. So for example, hierarchy looks a bit more different because we need more data. So we need like a parent ID and that's all. So we need ID and parent ID. But you get the gist. So now we know how it works. We can eat our cake and do this for everything. So we generate all the different models in our distributed system with this schema. And let's take a look. So now we have all of again for storage. But next, we want to generate the command. And the command for an all of is still a tuple. It's nothing different. And yeah, let's go for a repository to store the all of. Yeah, it's still a tuple. Yeah, that's repetitive. And yeah, let's look at events for an all of. Yeah, it's still a tuple. That looks boring. But not everything is that boring. These are basically type mappings. And if you wouldn't have looked at the all of implementation, then it would look different. For an entity set, every part of this is different. And yeah, let's look at an entity set then. So let's create a command for an entity set with an ID and an entity. So commands for an entity set involve like creation of a new entity. So we would create an entity. And to create an entity, we need the storage of this entity. So we need storage for the whole entity to store, create everything that is part of the entity. And we might want to remove an entity as well. So for removal, we just need an ID. So we use that. And we might also want to update an entity. For an update, we need the ID of the entity and also the update command for the entity. So it's different from storage for, because yeah, different types might use different commands in storage for. We've seen the storage for the entity and the command for we see here, and the entity might contain another entity set. So it would again accept create, destroy, and updates. So and now we have to combine everything to get the command for the entity set. And the combination is basically a variant of either a create, destroy, or an update. So it's just forwarding the template arguments, and the recursion happens in the create, destroy, and update type aliases. And if your system gets a bit more complicated, you might not want to update just one entity. You might want to change multiple entities at the same time or create multiple entities. So you change your command for and add a vector of these variants. So that's very easy change now. It's just a bit of work. You have to do it. And then, yeah, it works automatically. And that's the magic of generating code from the schema. Okay. So we now know how to derive all the complex types from our schema. But we don't have just types. We also have to process commands, for example. So let's look at this part. And we use the same trick here, but instead of creating types, we use a const explorer value. So we don't use decal type for the command processor. We actually use the return type. So how does the implementation of the command processor for looks then? So the type signature is the same. So it's a function. We use the ADL again, and also the schema type. So we have all the types available. So, but this time we just return a lambda and we build our type again. So the all of TS. So this is not recursive, but we only use it to get our commands and our repository. So the repository would store the current state of the values. And yeah, now the question is, what's the implementation of that? Again, we have to use just a recursive implementation. So we want to update all the types in our all of, so we just have to do that. So we use the command processor for each of our types, or for one of the types in the pack, and then extract the command. We know that the command is a tuple, so we can use standard get to extract one of the commands, and we can also extract them from the repository. As we have seen, the repository also is a tuple. And that's we repeat for all the types in our pack. That's the whole implementation of that. Obviously, if we would look at the implementation for an entity set, it's much different. And I wouldn't implement it in just one lambda because we have to implement each of the variants, like create, update, destroy. But you now have an impression that, and you can trust me, we can implement everything from our schema. So if you go back to our slide for the complex system, we now have the schema in the center of the distributed system. And we generate everything from the schema. So we generate the commands. We have seen that. And the validation is just another function. We can generate that. The storage, the repositories, yeah, simple. Done. Events, the same. And also our computations. We cannot actually generate everything in our system here, but everything that is boring, we can generate. So it takes out all the stupid stuff. And then the update as well is generated. And for Fuse, we have to take a closer look. So any questions so far on the schema code generation? So we go a bit more deep in the view models, but I see no messages. Okay, let's continue the journey. So question, oh, message. Are functions only declared for IDL or also implemented? I don't quite get the question. Basically, ADL is used all of the time for lookup of functions.
Yes. So my question, hello?
Yeah, hello.
So for example, you show the function storage four that receives all of and returns a tuple of the same arguments. Is this function only declared so the compiler can use it to know how to convert all of to a tuple? Or will it also be implemented using a make tuple or something?
This final implementation of the storage for implementation. And that's the final one. So we have the the type alias here, and it pretends to call the storage for function, and it's not actually calling it. So the storage for function is never even implemented. It's just a type signature of a function, but it's found through IDL because we are calling it with a pretended null pointer to an ADL construct, and also a null pointer to T. I'm not using standard decalval here because that is much slower than null pointer. And yeah, so the ADL is only used when we do this recursion internally. So when we call storage four for some type, we don't have to mention ADL anyways because it's just a type alias. And the type alias internally tries to refer to the storage four function. Could I make the point clear, or is it still unclear? Yeah, the function just for changing the type signature is never implemented. If we use for processing data, then we actually implement the function and return just the lambda. That's what we did here. So this function actually is implemented. It also uses the same ADL trick. But this time we are calling it actually. And it's also quite neat to know that this is a expert constant. So there's no runtime cost involved to calling it or using it. And this only works because we're returning a lambda. So the implementation of the lambda might not be const expert. So that's one thing you have to keep in mind. So it's only constexpr because we are just returning a lambda, but calling the lambda might not be constexpr itself. Okay, any other questions so far? So let's move a bit deeper and just investigate what we have to do for generating views. And we cannot actually generate views because we have not enough information in our type system. So we wouldn't know where to put an input field or if the string is a password or something like that. But what we actually do in UI systems usually is we generate few models. So let's do that at least. Just start happily like we did before. It's just another type transformation. So like storage 4, but a bit more complex. So we start up with view model 4, define our all of implementation. So that's quite easy. We just use another type alias. So we make an all of view model. And now we have to implement that. So if you know Qt, this looks a bit strange because Q objects are not like regular C++ objects. Q objects are a bit special. They inherit from Q object as a base class, but they also use the Q object macro. And Q object itself is not copyable or anything. And there are quite some rules involved because Q object macro is not actually implemented to anything. It's basically empty. It's not actually empty, but it doesn't do anything on its own. But it's used by a mock compiler. So the mock compiler will pass our C++ code and look for Q objects. And it finds those Q objects with a Q object macro. And what it does is then it implements more C++. But it cannot handle templates. Because to handle template, it would have to generate templates again. And how would that work if we use a different CPP file for the generated code from the mock file? So mock, the normal meta object compiler of QObjects, that's not capable of templates. So usually templates are not something you find in Qt applications. And yeah, we were a bit sad and said, yeah, we could then generate everything else except for the view models. And then I found the Wobok Verdigris. So Wobok is a very small company from Germany. And they created the Verdigris. And it's basically a plugin replacement for the mock compiler of Qt. And the big benefit of that is that it allows us to use templated Q objects. And what's actually doing? It uses C++ and macro magics to generate everything the mock compiler does. So it does nothing different than the mock compiler, but it uses C++. And because it uses C++, we can use templates. So it's very useful, even if you don't use the schema generation part of it. That's the GitHub link. But the aim of this project was basically to replace the mock compiler. And that's all fine and good. But we want to use it for schema generation. And it's actually not possible from the type system to invoke macros. So you have to dig a bit deeper. And what I did, I created a pull request that creates a new API for the Verdigris system that accepts constructs to C++ types to generate everything we need. So let's take a look. So instead of using the Q object macro, we use a W object. And that's the replacement from Verdigris. I guess W stands for Wobok. And because this time the macro actually implements something, we also have to give it a type name. It's a bit inconvenient, but yeah, nothing too major. And then the second part of it is that we use another macro to implement the QObject parts of it. And here we see that the template syntax is actually intended by the Verdigris system. So we pass the template arguments as well. And yeah, this is all fine and good. But now we have to use the inner parts of the object. So getting the outer part is OK. But now we want, for example, to have some properties on our Q object. And for this, I just added these C++ APIs. And the API is kind of simple. You know, we have to create a different structure. And this structure is invoked with a template argument, a non-type template argument. So it's a size T value with the index of the property. And to limit the amount of properties we generate, we have to limit the implementations. So for this, for example, we can use FinAE, or if we have C++ 20, we can use the require statement here. And with that, we have to implement. The structure only has one field. It's not even a field, it's a static constant. And this is the property. And this property uses in C++ to generate just the property. So we use this make property function from Vertigus. We give it a type. So QRiant is just a valid type because every property is finally put anyways in the QRiant, not in the C++ side, but if we use a QML application frontend, then it's always a QRiant. And then we pass the property name, so the name of the property, and the type name, that is QRiant name in this place, because yeah, it's the QRiant. And that's not all. We now have to add setters and getters. And for that, we use the same pattern. So we pass on the I parameter, not only to the property name, but also to the getter and setters. So we pass function references to the get property value. And this is a templated function, just with an I. And the last thing we have to do, we register it back to the macro system and use a property macro here. So we tell what kind of structure we want to pass as properties. And this kind of API is used for everything else. So the getters are kind of easy, it's C++ code, setters as well. But notify is an event, so a signal. And for that, we also generate implementations the same pattern. Okay, and property name, you have to return an Vertigus name string. So it's a const expo string, basically. So with this, we have all the parts. Now we can generate our views. That's basically everything I wanted to show you. Let's recap a bit. So we have studied a bit of a distributed system. So I describe what it is, how I imagine it. Then we took a detour to strong types. And with that, we got to the data schema parts. So, and data schemas we use to generate code. And finally, we built some Q objects. So we have few models now, basically a fully rounded system. So the advantages, we have a central schema definition, and it's used by all the developers, so we don't have to use a separate process to generate code. And our schema also is very tailored to our system, so we don't have to use terms that the standard definition language or something has implemented already. We can implement a hierarchy, or we can use something different, whatever we want in our domain. So make it as complex or as simple as we need it. And then, we have a very good separation of data and logic. So there's no shared definitions, so separated. This leads to a very good testable code. So overall, I think it's very versatile and good, but there's also some shadows, so some disadvantages. And the biggest disadvantage, it's very uncommon. So you have a very steep learning curve. And also, if you make errors in your schema and in schema generation parts, those are templates. And error messages and templates might be worrisome. But over the time, we got used to it. And I have to say now, it goes very fluently. So once we all the pitfalls in C++, like the ADL and so on, it works quite well. And we still have to have some C++ boilerplate, or it's not as clean as you would have used a DDL language or something like that. But I don't think it's too much, so it's very manageable. And also, if you think about it, generating code from a DDL is also kind of complex and not very easy and good to go. So using C++, so generating all the code, Yeah, that's very, very good, I guess. And what we also do right now is that we use the same pattern and don't generate any types or functionality. We just generate a printer. And these printers generate C++ code again. We use it only for very simple parts. And this helps us to disconnect from the schema in the beginning. Otherwise, you would have generate one part of the code from generate other part of the code and so on. This helps a bit with compile time as well. And it's also compile time is a very good hint. Yeah, your compile times may take a while because you have to generate everything. And it depends on how much complex things you'll do. At first, we did no hit on compile time, and we said, yeah, it's fine, goes everywhere. But then our developers became addicted and generated more and more code. So now we have like 50 generation patterns or something in our code base, and quite complex ones. So they take a while to compile. Some links again. So the Warbog Verdigris is very challenging. Also use it if you want to have a Qt application and have difficulties with the mock compiler. It also helps to simplify the build system because you only have to use a C++ compiler and no mock or Qt specific stuff again. There's also a GitHub project where I upload all my C++ basic types, basically. There's right now like a collection of different libraries for flags and so on. And there's also the basic CPP17 library, which we are using right now. And there's a CPP19 library, which uses C++ 20 features that are available right now in Clang and Visual Studio. And yeah, it has much better compile times. So that's the goal. Yeah, the talk slides are available on my GitHub account. And when I'm starting to talk about me, let's recap that a bit. So I'm Andreas Reischuk. You'll find me as UpMind everywhere. And the disclaimer, I work and founded the company Hickenhack Software. You can work with us. You can, if you want to work from Dessen. And there is the C++ user group in Dessen. We are always looking for good talks. So contact me if you want to give a talk here. And we do video recordings all the time. Also, if Corona goes away and we have present talks here. And I'm very willing to give you a tour around Dresden if you come here. And there's also my hobby project, which is a rebuild language project. If you're interested in creating a new language that is more expressive, it's not competing with C++, but it's a total different. So basically experimenting, how can we express ourselves better in computer languages? Yeah, contact me if you want to know more about it. I want to inspire you to try out more, try out maybe type-driven development. Yeah, there's some photos. And now I'm waiting your questions.